There are some major challenges to using silicon alloys for thin film solar cells. In the previous video, we discussed the light-induced degradation from which amorphous silicon suffers. In this video, we will discuss the challenges related to using surface roughness to increase trapping light in thin films. The learning objectives for this video are first to understand the necessity for light trapping techniques in thin films. We will then look at the different kinds of surface texturing applied and their effect on the performance of a solar cell. Finally, we will discuss the delicate interplay between texture and the quality of the absorber layers. To understand the necessity for light trapping, we will start with the absorption in amorphous silicon. This graph shows the fraction of incident light remaining on the y-axis as a function of the penetration depth in an amorphous silicon absorber layer. The blue line represents blue light at a wavelength of 400 nanometers. We can see that nearly all the blue light is already absorbed in the first 100 nanometers. Green light at a wavelength of 500 nanometers is not absorbed quite as fast. About 10% of the incident green light remains after traveling 500 nanometers through an amorphous silicon absorber. For yellow light, it takes 1500 nanometers for 90% of the incident light to be absorbed, and of the incident red light, only 20% is absorbed after traveling 5 microns through the absorber layer. As we recall, the charge carrier diffusion length is the typical distance light-excited charge carriers diffuse before they recombine. The diffusion length of amorphous silicon is somewhere between 100 and 300 nanometers. An amorphous silicon absorber is therefore typically a couple of 100 nanometers thick. At this thickness, a large fraction of the yellow, red, and infrared light remains unabsorbed. We therefore want to increase the optical thickness of the absorber without increasing its geometrical thickness. That is where surface texturing comes in. If a light beam under normal incidence encounters a solar cell with a flat surface, it will travel through the solar cell following the shortest possible path. Now, if we randomly texture the surface of the TCO layer, incident light will be scattered into a wide range of angles. Light is now deflected from the straight path and the path length of the light through the absorber layer is increased, without increasing the geometrical thickness of the absorber layer. Here a picture of typical textured fluorine doped tin oxide is shown. This tin oxide on glass is processed by the Japanese company Asahi Glass. This glass TCO substrate acts as the substrate for a hydrogenated amorphous silicon PIN junction. The shown surface roughness is the optimized texture for optimal light trapping in amorphous silicon single PIN junctions. This texture facilitates the light trapping in the important spectral range of 550 nanometers up to 700 nanometers, just above the bandgap of amorphous silicon. In the second picture, the textured surface of aluminium-doped zinc oxide processed at EPFL in Switzerland is shown, which acts as the substrate for nanocrystalline silicon PIN junction. This is the optimized texture for optimal light trapping in nanocrystalline silicon single PIN junction solar cells in the important spectral range of 550 nanometers up to 1100 nanometers. You can clearly see that the size of the surface features on the optimal texture for nanocrystalline silicon is larger in reference to the optimal texture for amorphous silicon. As explained in the PV1X photovoltaic energy conversion course, small surface features only effectively scatter the visible part of the spectrum. Larger features are required to efficiently scatter in light in the red to infrared spectral part. However, if both the amorphous silicon and nanocrystalline silicon junctions are combined in a tandem cell, more than one scale of texture at the various interfaces is required to facilitate the light trapping in the bottom and top cell. Therefore, a multi-step approach needs to be employed to produce small-scale texturing features on top of large-scale texturing features. Such a modulated surface texture effectively scatters light for a broad wavelength range. Various different approaches have been developed to integrate this multiscale texturing into a micromorph tandem cell. An illustrative example of modulated surface textures implemented in a micromorph tandem cell is this tandem cell processed at EPFL Neuchâtel in Switzerland in a so-called NIP configuration. This means that the nanocrystalline silicon bottom cell is deposited first and the amorphous silicon top cell is deposited on top of it. A 5 micron thick zinc oxide layer is used as substrate. The zinc oxide is processed using low pressure chemical vapor deposition. On top of the bottom cell, an intermediate zinc oxide reflective layer of 1.1 microns has been deposited using the same LPCVD process. This growth process creates a natural small texturing on top of the zinc oxide. Using this approach, an intermediate reflective layer with an asymmetric texturing was achieved. The amorphous silicon processed on top of this intermediate reflective layer adopts the small texture needed to realize an efficient light trapping in the top cell. As you can see, the large-scale texture of the substrate has been adapted through all the layers of the device, and the small-scale texture has been adapted by the top cell. This is an example of modulated surface texture and facilitates the good light trapping in both the top and bottom cell. Another approach to realize modulated surface texture is to apply a large-scale texture in the glass substrate. For this method, the size of the surface features on both the TCO interfaces is decoupled to even further increase the scattering effectiveness and wavelength range. However, can we just integrate such texturing in solar cells without any problems? To answer this question, we have to consider the impact of texturing on the performance of the solar cells. We will therefore continue our discussion of surface roughness in the next video.